The Eternal Repose video series is a controversial topic subject to conjecture and debate. The opinions shared in these episodes are not the official doctrines of the Christian Church, but are my own opinions developed through research and thoughtful contemplation. What is heaven? It is a question heard in a lot of different places and different contexts. Different religions attempt to answer this question in different ways, but the end product is similar. Heaven is a common religious, transcendent place where different heavenly beings such as gods, angels, jinn, saints, or holy ancestors dwell. In many religious traditions around the world, heavenly beings can descend to earth, and earthly beings can ascend to heaven in the afterlife. These different religions may not agree on divine purpose or location. They also may not agree on the various standards of heaven, but the religions of the world all agree that heaven exists. The concept of heaven we see in the Western world predominantly comes from the Christian point of view and the Bible, and it is closely linked to the reality of life after death. Heaven is often described as a higher place, the holiest place, a paradise, or New Jerusalem. Because of this fact, the goal of this video is to briefly examine the slow evolution of heaven over the last 3,000 years. To understand the concept of heaven in the Bible, we must recognize its linkage to the concept of an afterlife. The Semitic world of the early Hebrew people responded to the belief in an afterlife by forming a three-tiered vision of the cosmos. And these tiers are heaven, earth, and the netherworld. The lowest level in the netherworld, where the dead reside, the Hebrews referred to as Sheol, a place of darkness to which all the disembodied dead go, both righteous and unrighteous. Some early religions believed that the dead could be contacted in the afterlife. Therefore, they were honored and worshipped by familial descendants. The highest realm is heaven, which is occupied by the sky gods. The earth is the middle realm that is occupied by the living, who can supplicate the sky gods of the higher realm and their dead ancestors of the lower realm to help improve their earthly condition. The ancient Semitic cultures were obsessed with communicating with the dead in the netherworld. Therefore, they developed elaborate rituals and ceremonies designed to placate the dead. The ancient Semitics pictured the netherworld as a great cave situated deep below ground, that could be accessed through cave portals that lead to hell. This three-level view of the cosmos quickly led to elaborate forms of polytheism, the belief in more than one god. The Hebrew tribes of the early patriarchs rejected the polytheistic view of the cosmos professed by their neighboring societies. Loudly, the Hebrews proclaimed that there is only one God, and His name is Jehovah. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. This one verse is the heart of Judaism. There is only one God who is to be honored and worshiped. Early Judaism was slow to develop the doctrine of life after death and heaven, due partly to their rejection of polytheism and its elaborate religious myths and death rituals. The first five books of the Old Testament, called the Pentateuch or the Torah, is the backbone of Judaism. One thing that has been noted by Old Testament scholars is the fact that little mention is made in these books to the concept of an afterlife and the existence of heaven. Since this is the case, the immortality of the soul was not part of early Hebrew liturgy. Nearly all references to heaven in the early books of the Old Testament mention the sky and the abode of the stars. Heaven, as the Empyrean, the dwelling place of God, did not come about until fuller knowledge came from God through the prophets, who envisioned an afterlife that included both rewards and punishments. A classic example of this evolution of heaven can be found in the opening chapter to the book of Job. One day, the angels came and presented themselves to the Lord, and among this group was Satan, the fallen angel, once known as Lucifer. The discourse between God and Satan concerning Job is interesting, because God is clearly dwelling in an ethereal throne room that must be heaven. It clearly is not located on the earth. It must occupy an eternal spiritual dimension. The authors of the Book of Psalms also described heaven as God's sanctuary and abode, while Isaiah and Daniel both described an afterlife that seems to include heaven. No doubt, the truth of heaven and the afterlife was being made clear throughout the age of the Old Testament prophets. But the doctrines of heaven, the afterlife, and the resurrection of the dead came more into focus during the intertestamental period due to the Greek occupation of Israel by the Seleucids. The great Jewish philosopher and theologian, Philo of Alexandria, was the final rabbinical authority to teach on the doctrines of heaven and the immortality of the soul. Philo attributed much of his Greek philosophical insight to Plato, who he referred to as the most holy Plato. By the time Jesus came on the scene, the doctrines of heaven and the afterlife were firmly rooted in Jewish rabbinical dogma. Jesus taught often on the rewards found in heaven by those who love and trust him. This is especially true in the Beatitudes. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven belonged to those who are poor in spirit, and those who are persecuted, insulted, and lied about for their acts of righteousness." Jesus spent little time describing the attributes of heaven, but one thing he made abundantly clear: heaven is a kingdom, not a democracy. In the sample prayer given to us, known as the Our Father, Jesus made it very clear that God dwells in heaven, and that heaven is the throne room of his kingdom. It's logical that we should find a throne in the center of this kingdom. Throughout the Old Testament, God is seen sitting on his throne in the midst of heaven. King David, in the book of Psalms, understood that the throne of God was established for the purpose of issuing divine judgment, where he will judge the world in righteousness. We see this judgment in Revelation chapter 20, where we see a great white throne, and the one who sits on that throne will judge all the world. Those whose names are not found in the Lamb's Book of Life will be thrown into the lake of fire. Isaiah the prophet also saw the Lord seated on his throne, and about the throne were seraphim who cried out, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." The Apostle John experienced the same heavenly throne as Isaiah. He also heard the angels make the same proclamation. John also described the throne of heaven in Revelation chapter 7. But at this time, he saw a great multitude, so great that no one could number them. The context of chapter 7 clearly indicates that this multitude are saved saints. There are over 32 references in the New Testament alone where heaven is described as the kingdom of God, but these references do not provide a detailed description of heaven. The debate about heaven would take an interesting twist with two verses in the second book to the Corinthians. The Apostle Paul created an issue of conjecture when he referenced a man being caught up to the third heaven, referred to as paradise. According to Paul, this man heard such holy things that it was not lawful for any man to reveal them. The debatable issue in Paul's description is the idea that heaven has different levels. According to Paul, the man who spoke to him was caught up to the third heaven, and this location was identified with paradise. Are there different levels in heaven? No one knows for sure, but Hugo Grotius, a theologian in the 17th century, sought to apply logic to the question when he divided heaven into three parts. The first part was the atmosphere of planet Earth, while the second part was the sun, moon, and stars, with the third level of heaven being the abode of God. During the days of the Apostle Paul, the idea circulated that heaven had seven levels, with one level being called Shechakim. The Jewish Kabbalah makes such a declaration, and the Book of Enoch also describes the dimensionalism of heaven. But the concept of different levels of heaven was clearly articulated by Dante in his epic poem known as the Divine Comedy. Are there different levels of heaven? No one knows for sure. Jesus spent more time teaching on the resurrection than he did on heaven, but he seemed to link the idea of heaven with the resurrection. In the discourse Jesus had with the Sadducees about the resurrection, he indicated that those who participate in the first resurrection will never die, and they will be like the angels. Since this is not a discussion on the resurrection, let it suffice that the Bible teaches about the existence of heaven and its purpose as a resting place for the saints of God. Heaven was not a central issue in the early apostolic church. All eyes were turned to the eastern sky in anticipation of the second coming of Jesus Christ and the resurrection of the dead. These early Christians thought that the coming of Jesus and the resurrection could happen any day, and they were to prepare themselves to meet the Lord. At least 500 disciples of Christ understood that there would be a resurrection because they saw a resurrected Christ. These early saints could trust the teachings of Jesus concerning the resurrection because he rose from the dead himself. These thoughts occupied some of the earliest writings coming from the fledgling church. This would be logical, since the early church was mostly centered in the greater Jewish community, where the Pharisaic concept of resurrection was strong. Slowly, the passing of years turned to decades, and the early church still yearned in anxious anticipation for the coming of the Lord and the resurrection. Rumors began to circulate that the day of the Lord and the resurrection had come and gone. Paul, in his second letter to the Thessalonians, sought to squelch these rumors by writing, "Concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, we ask you, brothers, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by some prophecy, report, or letter supposed to have come from us, saying that the day of the Lord has already come. Don't let anyone deceive you in any way, for that day will not come until the rebellion occurs and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the man doomed to destruction. He will oppose and will exalt himself over everything that is called God or is worshiped, so that he sets himself up in God's temple, proclaiming himself to be God." Decades pass with no resurrection. Saints kept dying from disease, war, famine, and persecution. The same question arose in the early church that troubled the Jewish nation during the bloody persecution of the Greeks during the Maccabean period. And that question was, what happens to the dead martyrs? Irenaeus, Bishop of Lyons, is believed to have authored a report to the neighboring Christian community in Vienne, France, of the 175 AD persecution that nearly destroyed the Christian community of Lyons. The report chronicled the fact that the saints' persecutors burned their mutilated bodies and threw their ashes into the river Rhone in order that they may not even hope in the resurrection. The very fact that the hostile mob of Lyons committed this egregious act only confirms that the early Christians put their faith in a future resurrection more so than heaven. Another document, known as the Martyrdom of Polycarp, contains the same trust in the resurrection. In his last prayer before dying, Polycarp firmly confessed his belief in the resurrection of eternal life of both soul and body, made incorruptible by the Holy Spirit. Irenaeus of Lyons, in his book Against Heresies, rejected the idea of the ascending to heaven of the martyrs as being Gnostic in origin. He instead insisted that the divine compensation of the martyrs was to receive their earthly lives back again. Irenaeus was a strong proponent of the coming millennium of Jesus Christ, where the righteous dead would rise to rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. Irenaeus wrote that during this millennial period, the world would be extremely fertile, and women would give birth to numerous children. Nature itself would produce wine and oil in such abundance that people would no longer need to work. The idea of a future millennial reign of Jesus Christ fell into disfavor during the 4th century due to Christianity becoming the state religion of Rome. The future of Christianity looked bright with the decline of persecution and the Christianization of Rome. The idea of a future worldly millennium was seen as a materialistic carnal world that could not be compared with the glory found in Jesus Christ. Greek dualistic disdain for all things of this world eroded the worldly millennium presented by Irenaeus to the point that it fell into disfavor and seen as divisive. Living long on a fertile earth and having many children held no attraction for the Christian community of the 4th century. Christians now long for spiritual rest and enjoyment of God's presence. Eternal life with God would commence without a millennium. Well, this may be true, but what are we going to do with the martyrs and all the faithful who died in Christ. The idea of heaven and the immortality of the soul returned to the public discussion. The chief architect of the new spirituality was Augustine, Bishop of Hippo, who wrote extensively in the latter 4th and early 5th centuries. Augustine, in his manuscript, City of God, looked on Roman society with great suspicion. He considered everything of this world to be alien to the Christian ideal. He moved away from the resurrection-centered view of the afterlife to a more Greek dualistic view that spirit was superior to matter, and the ecclesiastical community of heaven was far greater than the realm of earth. Augustine believed that the supreme bliss of heaven would be in seeing God directly. He wrote, "There we shall rest and see and love and praise. This shall be in the end without end. He shall be the end of our desires. Who shall be seen without end, loved without cloy, praised without weariness?" Toward the end of his life, Augustine also included the concept of being reunited with our departed loved ones and family and community, similar to the angels. The idea of being reunited with our long-dead family in the netherworld is distinctively Greek in origin and predates Christianity by centuries. Ambrose, Bishop of Milan, the teacher of Augustine, was the first Christian bishop to expound the idea that our family will be reunited with us after death. Augustine's vision of heaven eventually became the official orthodoxy of Roman Catholicism. But the bigger question was, how shall we see God in heaven? The Western Roman Church confessed that we shall see God as He is, face to face, while the Eastern Greek Church believed that we shall see the theophany of God, a visible manifestation, not the true essence. The Eastern Church placed more emphasis on the doctrine of spiritual theosis than on God, the process of being united with God in His likeness. According to the Greek Orthodox Church, theosis is brought about through the purification of mind and body. This difference between East and West may seem subtle, but it became a dividing point between Roman Catholicism and Greek Orthodoxy for centuries to come. In the Western Church, Augustine's version of heaven remained stable for several centuries. The next evolution of heaven came from the monasteries, who were the intellectual centers of Europe during the Dark Ages. The monks envisioned a day when God would reverse the fall of Adam and restore the original paradise of Eden. At the end of time, God would recreate a new earth where all the righteous would be released from all forms of human toil. With the change of the first millennium came confusion and social unrest in both rural and urban living. The poets, theologians, and philosophers sought to fix a stable society in the other world. The order and hierarchy of medieval society could be seen in the perceived hierarchy of heaven. Some writers place Christians and Jews in different parts of heaven, while some theologians attempted to segment heaven by geographical origin. Others attempted to arrange heaven by types of sin and virtue, or by social standing or class. Some even segmented heaven by family tree. Monks continued to put monks first on the grounds they were more devoted to God than common laity. From the latter 11th century to the 13th century, monks tended to rank their own brethren above all others. Male clergy usually ranked themselves higher in heaven than women or laity. A monk of Arras even went to the extreme that he ranked the apostles and prophets of the Bible by position of importance in heaven. He then ranked hermits after the apostles and prophets, then monks, then bishops, then priests, then laity, and finally laywomen. The monasteries began to lose their central intellectual focus in European society because of their lack of consistency and their method of education. During the 12th and 13th centuries, the center of intellect shifted from the monasteries to the universities. From these universities, a new theology developed that was centered on scholarship. Chief among the new scholars of theology was Thomas Aquinas. During the medieval era, Western Europe rediscovered the philosophies of Aristotle, a Greek philosopher and scientist from the 4th century BC. And this reintroduction of Aristotle changed the theological landscape concerning heaven. In the 13th century, St. Thomas Aquinas, an Italian Dominican friar, a Catholic priest, and an influential philosopher and theologian, used the writings of Aristotle and other Muslim philosophers to form a geocentric universe that arranged the cosmos into concentric spheres. According to Aquinas, the Earth occupied the lowest point in the innermost sphere, and the outermost sphere was the prime mobile, which keeps the universe in order. Beyond the spheres was the Empyrean, the dwelling place of God. Thomas Aquinas also wrote that the physical cosmos is an allegory of the true, real cosmos, which manifests the utterance of God. He believed that Aristotelian physics was an inferior truth, pointing to the greater truth, which included both moral and divine. The vision of Thomas Aquinas concerning the cosmos remained a staple in astronomy and physics until the mid-20th century, where the physical became more real than the moral, the exact opposite of the theory fostered by Thomas Aquinas. St. Thomas Aquinas also wrote that the greatest blessing we can have in heaven is to perceive the eternal essence of God. He also emphasized that heaven included four elements of love, vision, comprehension, and the communion of the saints. Heaven would be the eternal fellowship of the blessed, past, present, and future in Christ. Aquinas also emphasized that true perfection must wait until the resurrection and last judgment, when we are reunited with our bodies. The other debate that surfaced during the medieval era was whether we shall see God in heaven. The two schools of thought centered on the teachings of Saint Augustine, who was bishop of Hippo during the early 5th century AD, and Aristotle. Augustine asserted that those in heaven would see God face to face, without any form of medium. Augustine's theology was the traditional view of Roman Catholicism for nearly 1,000 years. The opposing point of view was presented by scholars and theologians who supported Aristotle's view that it was impossible to see God because human finite intellect could not comprehend the infinite essence of God. These theologians, who were known as Aristotelians, used 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 16, as supporting evidence that no one can see or ever will see God. This argument asserted that those souls in heaven would only see the theophany, a visible manifestation of God, but not His true essence. In 1241, the University of Paris settled the debate for the remainder of the Middle Ages, when they asserted that God is seen in heaven in His essence and substance by the angels and the blessed in heaven. During the latter days of the medieval period, the accepted view of heaven took a strange turn with the official ratification of purgatory at the Council of Lyons in 1274. Heaven ceased to be God-centered, but now became centered in Rome. The Pope claimed sovereign authority to determine who was admitted to heaven and who was not. This power grab by the Pope became a cash cow, with the Vatican selling indulgences to the wealthy of Europe. Eternal life and heaven was shrouded by the scriptural and spiritual distortions of the Pope. Heaven being lost to the greed of the Pope caused considerable friction in the clergy and laity of Western Europe. With the coming of Martin Luther in the 16th century, Reformation religious turmoil came to a boil. For the next 3 centuries, the political boundaries were redrawn by bloody religious war between the Catholics and the Protestants. The realignment of Europe also generated a readjustment in the understanding of heaven. The Reformation rejected the Rome-centered concept of heaven in favor of a God-centered Christian experience. The writings of Augustine came back to the surface with an emphasis on a God-centered spiritual experience. Martin Luther and John Calvin added one additional element to the mix of heaven and eternal life. Monastic living no longer was necessary to attain spiritual maturity, but a God-centered secular life centered in Jesus Christ and the Bible was preferred. Martin Luther and John Calvin both rejected the prevailing Rome-centered sacramental system filled with pilgrimages and indulgences. In their opinion, the legalism of Rome could not be a source of salvation. Both Luther and Calvin shifted the concept of salvation away from Rome to a God-centered relationship. Calvin wrote, "There is no part in our life and no action so minute that it ought not to be directed to the glory of God." Slowly, the concept of God and heaven turned from Rome back to the Bible. At the death of Luther, Philip Melanchthon, in his eulogy, said, "He has entered that vastly higher school where he can contemplate the essence of God, the two natures joined in Christ, and the whole purpose set forth in founding and redeeming the church." The Reformation teachers reintroduced Augustine's concept of seeing God face to face in heaven. They also taught that we will be equal. Luther wrote, "We will be equal to St. Paul, St. Peter, and our beloved Lady, and all the saints in their honor and glory." Luther also walked a fine line when he distinguished between saints in regards to their heavenly rewards. Luther's concept was a task-based system of rewards. For example, Peter would have a different reward than Paul simply because their tasks were different. The Puritan movement of the 17th century maintained the basic teachings of Luther and Calvin, but especially Calvin. The Puritan concept of heaven was expressed in Richard Baxter's Saints' Everlasting Rest. His vision of heaven was theocentric, with worship the preeminent activity. During the 18th century, a more material, anthropocentric view of heaven began to emerge, with human love and progress characterizing life in the new order. Anthropocentricism is the belief that humankind is the central, most important element of existence. Emanuel Swedenborg, in the latter 18th century, claimed to be a mystic who was allowed to visit heaven and talk with the angels. By the time of his death in 1772, Swedenborg had published numerous books based upon his experiences. In his work, A Theocentric Vision of Heaven lost ground to an anthropocentric understanding. God, the creator of heaven, was becoming second fiddle to a human-centered vision of heaven. This anthropocentric view became more prominent in the 19th century, with depictions of family reunions, creative activity, and spiritual growth filling out the popular concept of heaven. By the mid-19th century, Swedenborg had a lot of company. In the United States alone, over 50 books were published that presented an attractive and well-ordered description of heaven. Some of these works were extreme flights of fancy. The imagery of heaven was becoming clouded and confused by these fantastical works. By the 20th century, theologians rejected the anthropocentric view of heaven, fostered by 19th century extremism, and they also rejected the liturgical images of the theocentric heaven. The next major change in heaven and the afterlife came from the social gospel movement of the early 20th century. Walter Rauschenbusch, the famed American theologian of the social gospel, insisted in his book, Christianity and the Social Crisis, that heaven was not a reality after death, but the symbol of a perfected world here and now. The social gospel movement rejected the idea of a personal afterlife in heaven in favor of a regenerated social order on earth. The idea of bringing forth heaven on earth is nothing more than repackaged postmillennialism presented by Daniel Whitby, rector of St. Edmund's Church in Salisbury, England in 1703. The regenerated social order of the social gospel movement lost its vision of heaven in political rhetoric and empty activism. In the latter half of the 20th century, the anthropocentric view of the social gospel lost ground to a resurgence of a theocentric vision of heaven from the Protestant evangelicals and fundamentalists. Heaven is the throne room of God. Heaven is about God. It is not about humankind. The Swedenborg fanciful visions of heaven and the social gospel's view of heaven on earth do nothing but remove God from the equation. The belief in a new heaven, a new earth, and a heavenly new Jerusalem coming to earth grew in popularity from the dispensational teachings of end-time prophecy preachers. In May of 2004, a Gallup poll survey revealed that 81% of the people surveyed believed in heaven. This is up from the same survey in 1997, where 72% believed in heaven. The general consensus among those surveyed was that all people will eventually attain heaven. The idea of heaven has come back into public awareness with the movie Heaven is for Real and the new television series called Project Afterlife. Each of these productions reinvigorate the belief in heaven as the destination of all good people after they die. The belief that all our dearly departed go to heaven is a modified form of the doctrine of universal reconciliation taught by Origen of Alexandria in the 3rd century AD and Gregory of Nyssa in the 4th century. Community was the central idea to the early church, because life and death depended upon a cohesive community. The ecclesia, the body of Christ encompassing the earth, was a reoccurring theme in the writings of the early church fathers. They saw the ecclesia as a community that exists eternally with Christ, embracing all ages from the beginning to the end. The idea of heaven being the eternal resting place in the hereafter was not as predominant as the idea of the ecclesia uniting with Christ and establishing his kingdom on earth. On 32 different occasions, in the Gospel of Matthew alone, heaven is linked with the kingdom of God. Jesus made it very clear that only those who will do the will of God the Father will enter heaven. He said, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven." Contrary to popular opinion, heaven is not the eternal resting place for all who have died. There is a condition, and that condition is doing the will of God. Being good is not enough. To bring this video to a conclusion is difficult and frustrating because there is so much more that can be said about the slow evolution of heaven. But I want to make one thing perfectly clear. I strongly believe in heaven. Where I disagree with the common perception is that good action opens the doors of heaven. The key to heaven is not good deeds, but faith in Jesus Christ. It is foolish to think we can believe in a Christian view of heaven, but not accept the truth of Christ. Heaven is not about you and me. It's about Jesus and his Father. It is a theocentric union with God. The Apostle John wrote, "Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure." Those of us who maintain this hope in Jesus Christ strive to purify ourselves even as he is pure. Maybe the Greek Orthodox concept of theos is not far from the truth. Theos is a transformative process whose goal is union with God in his likeness. Let's consider this thought. Theos does not stop with our physical death. We continue to grow in our union with God. While in heaven, we shall always seek more union with Christ and be granted more without end. We can never know God to the extent that he knows himself. We shall reach our ultimate potential when we know God to the greatest extent that we can know him.